goals of higher education, knowledge and critical foresight leading to societal responsibility. Please.
Excellencies, honorable members of the Academy, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it's indeed a great honor for me to be accepted as an honorary fellow of the Academy. And I consider this honor more as an obligation to help building bridges in a world that abounds in serious problems which must be overcome in order not to lose our confidence in a beneficial future of mankind. And this is also the subject of my brief lecture today. Of course, it's enormously difficult to speak after Professor Atta Ur-Rahman. I mean, he is an insider. He has achieved so much. I'm an outsider. I can't just give out advices from outside. And he is indeed one of my heroes as a scientist, as a politician, and in particular as a combination of both. And that happens so seldom in our world. I have not to say actually much more than is contained in the title of my lecture here. I will speak about educational goals at universities. I will speak about knowledge, wisdom, and critical foresight. And my dream, as always, is to promote societal responsibility at universities. But at first, I'd like to congratulate you to these 20 years of beneficial activity in a needy world. And indeed, if we look globally, it has not been a good 20 years. I mean, we have actually to be ashamed that we did not improve peacefulness. In contrary, our world has become more violent than ever before. And indeed, in the Middle East, to be more specific, the situation is particularly tragic. I mean, today we have catastrophes, we have wars, environmental damage, we have selfishness and greed, corruption, crime, and poverty all over the world. And if we wouldn't have our belief in the benevolence of human beings, we actually would lose our hope for the future. I'm sure that many of the world's greatest problems will be decided in the Middle East. And in this sense, the Islamic World Academy of Sciences will have to play a leading role to warrant peaceful and sustainable future globally. And I think the responsibility is very large, and it is centered around the following terms: cooperation, tolerance, and foresight. And these are three terms which should guide also our universities. And I think to achieve these goals, indeed, we need the universities, and we have to go from the academy to the university and appear that the actors who actually can implement thoughts which are being developed within the academy. So indeed, we are focusing on our universities. And I mean, if you look at the academic life, we have in essence a split world. Our exciting world in our laboratories, science makes so much fun. And on the other side, we have the world that is suffering, the world at large. Being squeezed into these technological achievements and other problems which occur. And very often, we scientists, we don't want to think about it. And you know, Nawab Jan Fishan Khan has said, the candle is not here to illuminate itself. The universities have not just internal reasoning for doing what they want to do, but they have a mission. They have a mission to the outside, and that is meant by this candle which should illuminate the remainder of the world. So I think it's up to us to build bridges. Bridges over the gaps which exist based on tolerance. And you know there are all these gaps in our world between the rich and the poor, within the countries, between rich and poor countries. We have to build these kind of bridges. We have to build bridges between developed countries and developing countries. We have to build bridges between the different religions, which is very important today. So these are goals which we have in front of us. And I think that boils down to three responsibilities, three academic responsibilities. Is first of all, of course, is education. But I say particularly education of future leaders. We need leaders in society. We don't need just specialists. We need leaders. And secondly, we have to do research in order to solve the great problems which are in front of us. And finally, we have to help planning a beneficial future. We have to look ahead and plan what should come, where we have to have real goals in front of us and not just running in an arbitrary direction. I'd like first to say a few words on educating future leaders. Of course we need skills, of course we need knowledge, but knowledge is not all. We need in addition understanding, and understanding I would like to summarize in the term wisdom. That's what we need. And finally we need also ethics and responsibility. So that's all what we need, and we shouldn't stop here just at the level of the knowledge. We should go further. And you know, we often speak about the knowledge society and say that those who know more are expected to accomplish more, earn more, and in the end to live a happier life. Of course, to some extent it's true, but that's not all. We need more than just knowledge. I mean, it's a process going from the experiment to the measurement to the data, perception which leads to the knowledge. But then the last step is probably the most important one, to recognize, to try to combine, and finally to achieve what we might call wisdom. And you know, wisdom is the ability developed through experience, insight, and reflection to discern truths and exercise good judgment. Something which is very difficult to learn in lecture rooms. It cannot be taught, but it has to be developed by experience. So our students, our learners, they have to have the possibility to experience themselves. And in this sense, I think a school should not be just a place for memorizing facts and to fill up the memory in order finally to be ready for real life later on, after 25 years of learning. The school itself should already be an integral part of life, providing lasting experience while addressing realistic problems. And I think we don't need any teachers. Teachers are not necessary. What we need are motivators. Professors who motivate the students to learn. And if a student is motivated, then he learns by itself. The learning has to be done by the student himself. That's what the main function of professors is. And I think on projects, it's particularly easy to learn. Have realistic projects and not just writing on the blackboard something, complicated formulas or anything like that. That's pretty useless. Let me say a few words on research, the second point here, which is very essential. And you know that everybody in principle is a researcher. Everybody from birth onwards is interested to explore the world. And he is sensing here the sweet. And this is actually me. And I'm sensing NMR. What is NMR? That's nuclear magnetic resonance. And I'd just like to tell you a brief example what I did in my life just to illustrate what research can be done, can be achieved. I mean, of course, nuclear magnetic resonance has something to do with the molecules. We have the atoms here. When we blow up, we see a single atom. In the center of the atom, we find the nucleus here, atomic nucleus, and that's the object which we address. And the atomic nucleus, it contains a magnetic moment. It's magnetic, and at the same time, it's rotating about its own axis. And when we apply a magnetic field, then it starts to precess about the magnetic field. And this precession frequency, which is just proportional to the local magnetic field strength, that's what we are measuring. And because the local fields in different parts of a molecule, which you are not allowed to touch, alcohol, it has three protons here, so in the methyl group, the methylene group, and the OH group here. They have different environments, so we get a spectrum, and we get, so to say, a fingerprint of this molecule, which we can use in analysis. But I mean, to record such a spectrum is enormously slow. We have to go slowly, point by point through the spectrum. It's like letting a snail crawl across a spectrum, and today we don't have time for that. So we invented, that means me and my supervisor at Varian in Palo Alto in 1964, another technique which we just bang on the molecule. All the nuclei, they start to precess at once, an overlap of all the frequencies. We do a mathematical Fourier transformation. We get the spectrum in a fraction of a second, much faster than the snail, and we get beautiful spectra. Of course, we want to know more, not just fingerprints. We want to know the structure of a molecule. For that, one needs two-dimensional spectroscopy. I don't go into the details in the moment. And then, based on that, one can finally determine really molecular structures. We can really construct a model of a molecule. And we know almost everything we ever want to know about a molecule. That led to the call from Stockholm, and I had to travel to Stockholm, meeting the king, being able to shake hands with him, and he, that's my sentence here, which I got lifelong. But I mean, you know, the handshake, it was my first handshake with the king, but the handshake which impressed me much more was this one here. It's a beautiful queen. And I pressed very long and very hard. And she didn't scream, but afterwards she told me, next time be more earnest. And the king agreed and my wife agreed. Anyway, that's how it goes. And NMR is really a beautiful tool. It's a ladder which you can climb up from physics to chemistry to biology up to medicine and explore whatever you want to know about nature. You can explore biological molecules in solution, solid materials, and in particular in medicine. The technique has been really of great success. So you can put a gentleman into a magnetic field and explore whatever you ever want to know about him, whether he has a strong spine here, whether there is something in the brain, whether he has soft knees, everything you can find out. It's marvelous, and that's by chance my own head. Many people were astonished that there is something inside, but anyway, that's not my head. I mean, you see a brain tumor very neatly displayed here, very important information for a medical doctor, for a surgeon. You can, no, that doesn't apply to you. That applies to those countries which consume much too much alcohol. And you see here females, a normal female, an alcoholic female, brain shrinking, male patient, and an alcoholic, you see, the shrinking is less here. So whenever you get a bottle of wine, then drink it yourself and don't give it to your wife. I mean, it would do much more harm to her. So that's the advice here. The small glass on this side and the big glass on this side. Keep that in mind. Anyway, afterwards you can really test whether you have still a brain left with functional magnetic resonance imaging. You can, for example, apply a signal to a person and see how he reacts. And when he reacts like this, then he is a normal person. When he reacts like that, he might be schizophrenic if this reaction occurs in this area here. So you can really discover disease states. You can distinguish between a musician and a normal person. A normal person has a symmetrical response in brain upon a musical excitation, and a musician has this asymmetric response. You can learn something about compassion. So it's really psychology which is coming in. If you have a friend who is tortured, he feels pain. That's what happens in his brain. These are the reactions under pain. And you are just seeing what happens to him, and you feel pity with him, and you get the reaction exactly in the same areas in the brain as well. That's compassion. So that's now really, you can explore psychology on physical grounds. You can learn something about acupuncture. So it's indeed true that research is for the benefit of society. You can do quite a lot to help people in hospital and in research as well. Now, what is needed in order to be creative? I mean, it has been said already before that you have to start very early in childhood. So this childish curiosity, these questions after questions which the children pose, they should be maintained for later on. And then searching for answers, that's the secret for making inventions. A creative unrest is necessary, and that will hopefully lead to innovations. But you need more. You need, in addition, also a broad horizon. If you are a narrow-minded specialist, you will achieve nothing in life. You need knowledge in several fields at the same time. Interdisciplinary thinking is important, and inspiration by analogy. Very often you find something in a completely different field which suddenly reveals to you that you could apply it in your own field. So, I mean, if you have a goal in front of you and you are walking along here as a scientist, I'm hopping on a single leg, you know how difficult that is. You need other legs. You need passions in addition, which make you really a true human being which can walk along this road. And then, due to the interaction of the two fields, creativity starts to occur. It starts to sparkle in your brain. So that's important. Have additional passions in addition to the profession. And you need more. You need this inquietude, conflicting feelings. I mean, people are very complicated beings. You need to switch between self-confidence and self-critic. Sometimes you feel great, sometimes you feel weak. This belongs to a creative person. You have to be stubborn to follow this pathway to the goal, but sometimes you have also to be flexible. When you lead into a dead end, you have to concentrate and to relax. Again, let's have this goal in front of us. I mean, this might lead to a dead end. And suddenly you discover that there is a side road coming on. And that's what is being called serendipity. So you have to take then this road and get out of sight. And this will be finally much more fruitful. So you need this kind of flexibility to leave the road whenever necessary. But you need more. You need partners for discussion. You cannot do it alone. You need an open dialogue. You need openness for critics. You have to accept critics from others. And you need honesty. Honesty for, especially towards oneself. Cheating oneself, that's the worst whatever can happen. And honesty towards the others as well. And you need collaboration. And universities, they need this collaboration with industry, and it has been mentioned before, this industrial park just across the road here at Metu, for example. I mean, this kind of collaboration is important. And the only way to collaborate is to exchange people. I mean, email is useless. Cellular phones are useless. You have to exchange people. You have to walk from one place to another. And I cannot imagine a professor who has never worked in industry. I mean, just being all the time in the ivory tower, how do you want to educate students for the outside life? You have to experience yourself possibly as a postdoc like myself for 5 years in the United States. You can spend a sabbatical in the industry, you can start your own company, but you need a contact to industry, otherwise you can't perform your teaching performance. Scientists and engineers, they should come regularly back to the university to spend some time at the university, so to say, to fill up again. Knowledge and wisdom, have collaboration on joint projects, and of course, bringing experience into the university teaching. One needs this experience from industry, otherwise the universities become sterile. And then finally, the continuing education, which is a task jointly responsible for by professionals, jointly responsible for by industry and by the university. And they have to train regularly professionals and also the public in general. I come back at the very end to an example which we have done in Zurich recently, teaching the public, but that comes much later. Now, I'm coming to the third point. Planning of our future, and I think that's probably the most important point I want to stress here, and the one which one doesn't normally is aware of, that this is also a responsibility of universities. I mean, you see, that's me. I'm doing fundamental research here, down in the research shaft, working on fundamental science. And you see, we scientists, we are normally not interested in what happens here, up here in the on the world, but we are just excited by our own research results and perhaps by those of the competitors. And if there are clouds appearing up here, we don't notice them. And what would we experience when we would come out of our research shaft? The reality. We would find a population which has an unlimited faith in technology. They think whatever problem exists in the world, we engineers, we scientists, we can solve them if we just have enough money. They have an unlimited faith in free market economy. The freer the market, the more money one can make, and what other goal does one have in life? Unlimited personal freedom, that's also what one claims. State is not necessary. We don't need taxes. Taxes are a nuisance. Let's reduce the taxes as much as possible. And I mean, afterwards, we are astonished that the gap between the rich and the poor increases. And he asks us questions. What does Korea have to do to gain more Nobel Prizes? And we answered, yeah, one has to support the research better financially, one has to leave them freedom, one has to rate by quality, one has to bring foreigners into the country, and so on. And he said, thank you. Next day, we went to the president, Roh Moo-hyun, and we had a discussion with him, and his first question was, what does Korea have to do to gain more Nobel Prizes? And we gave him the same answers, and he said, thank you, and you know what happened in between. Then he went to the laboratory here of Professor Wu Suk Wang, president and Mrs. President here, and they watched the human cloning, which turned out to be a huge fake, and he was spinning away like a nuclear spin. And shame on our competitive society, shame on science, and it has much to do with the pressure on scientists to produce glamorous results, and this can lead to sloppiness and even to fraud. Be careful by putting too much pressure on scientists to perform, otherwise they might go in this direction. And I mean, it has something to do also with values. I mean, we have here the whole scale of values, from the cultural values, ethical values, down to racism and violence, and in the middle, of course, the monetary dominance. And we have today a darkening of the upper half, so to say, a loss of values, and the monetary dominance is still here, and all the rest as well. I mean, it has been described in a book by Robert H. Frank, Cornell professor in the United States, luxury fever, which means that when your neighbor has something, you also want it. And it's a contagious illness. You also want it to have it. For example, this bloody nonsense of the sports utility vehicles in the American parking lots, which just use a lot of gas, but serve no real purpose. I mean, that is part of this illness. And so today, we are sitting in this acceleration trap, which rotates faster and faster every day, and what remains at the end? Just stress. And you see, on this shaky ground, our children have to grow up. And that's what we have prepared for them, and what should be their goal in life. I mean, in Germany, 150 years ago, we have created the term Zappelphilip. You see, that's Zappelphilip. He cannot sit still on his chair. You see already what happens. And here, that's a disaster which happened. He disappeared, and the father, "You damn kid," and the mother, "Oh, my dishes, they are all gone." I mean, that was 150 years ago, but today we have more scientific terms. We speak about the attention deficit disorder, children which cannot sit still anymore on the chair, not as nicely as you do. And in Switzerland, we produce a drug, Ritalin, sells very well, especially in this country, in the background, there is this Ritalin nation, and by this we can keep our children in good behavior. But is that now really a cure, or is it more a killing by drugs? That's a big question. So I think we are caught in an identity crisis, in a crisis of objectives, and we are in great need of novel, comprehensive, and lasting approaches. And the question is then, who will keep our boat afloat? Will that be politics, economy, or the academic community? Of course, we have all three, we have to work together. Everybody has his responsibility, but the academic community in particular. If you look at this curve here, that's a truth curve. This tells you who tells the truth, and it's a public poll in England taken in 2001, 5 years ago. It's probably still true today. And they say that normal people, they are lying about 50% of the time. Doctors lie only 10%, professors 20% of the time, scientists 30%, but these down here, I mean, they lie almost all the time. I mean that it's not necessarily the truth, but I mean, that's a public opinion in England, and that tells us that we up here, we have particular responsibility. We, in this triangle between politics, humanities, and economy, we have responsibilities to carry on. And they refer particularly to honesty and to foresight. Foresight for creating a beneficial future. I'd like to give universities three advices. First advice, open the university's mind. Change the university's culture internally in the university. Then secondly, critically observe what is going out in the world itself. And thirdly, become active. I will briefly go through these three advices one by one. I mean, Mahatma Gandhi, he said it, we have to be the change we want to see in the world. We can't blame just anybody else. We have to do it ourselves. We have to change it and hope that this will finally change the world. So let us try to convert our academic institutions into radiating cultural centers with an impact on society. Just not ivory towers closed in themselves, but radiating cultural centers. And let's be reminded that science does not solve global problems alone. We need, in addition, also empathy, we need compassion, and we need foresight. You know, there is so much beyond the limits of what can be explored by the exact sciences. I mean, this guy here looking through the horizon here, he might be a humanist, and he might try to comprehend human reactions, thoughts, feelings, anxieties, happiness, love, and hatred. Of course, magnetic resonance imaging helps you already to enter these fields a little bit, but after all, these are fields of the humanities. And so I think it's important to break the barriers between the natural sciences and the humanities and the social sciences in our universities, open the departments, and let them cross-talk. Perhaps this will open avenues towards wisdom. I mean, it's attributed to Muhammad that he said, in eloquence there is magic, in knowledge there is ignorance, in poetry there is wisdom, and in speech heaviness. So it's poetry which contains wisdom. And I just like to project you one single little poem by Rumi, which is a very beautiful poem and which contains so much truth, much more than we ever can find out with our science. The morning wind spreads its fresh smell. We must get up and take that in, that wind that lets us live, breathe before it's gone. I think it's important to have this kind of connections also to the other reality, which we cannot perceive directly with our science. And that leads us also to ethics. I mean, ethics is important, and there ethics is all around. We just have to pick it up. We can pick ethics from philosophy. That's an important philosopher, Hans Jonas, who was writing about the principal responsibility, and he says that the application of science results demands ethics. We need ethics when we apply science. And he asks also, what can serve us as a compass? What can direct us? And he just says, the anticipated danger itself. Let's look ahead and see where our actions lead, and that tells us what we should do and what not. Of course, we can base our ethics on the Ten Commandments, which are the basis of all the three great monotheistic religions. And they, if you read them properly, they will lead to responsibility. They lead to tolerance. We can go to a Christian formulation of the same, of the foundation of global ethics, for example. And if you read all these statements, I can't go through the details, it will lead to responsibility and tolerance. You can interpret it in the form of the Islamic ethics, the Al-Quran, and go through all these statements here. And if you read them properly, they lead to responsibility and tolerance. And finally, you can go to Buddhist ethics, Buddhist philosophy, right understanding, right mindedness, right speech, and so on. If you properly use them, they also will lead to responsibility and tolerance. So they all lead to the same result. And the foundations are essentially virtually the same. So all great religions have common foundations. Only their surfaces differ. And if we would recognize this fact, it would be much easier to live together. And the religions are just different languages. Different languages for expressing exactly the same facts. Let's try to remember that, and then we could live together in peace. I mean, these are perhaps also important statements going into a slightly different direction by Prophet Muhammad and by Rumi. The worst of scholars is who visits princes, and the best of princes is who visits scholars. And the worst of scholars is who accepts help from princes and whose welfare and salvation is dependent upon and stems from fear of princes. It means just independence, academic independence, but of course one cannot go to the extreme. And if we look at Professor Atta Uraman, of course he's a prince at the same time and a scholar, so it can also be combined in one person. So, and of course we depend in some way also on politics, but it just means we have to remain spiritually independent. But that needs teachers. teachers who have vision and global responsibility. In addition to their speciality, they have to be the best in their field, but they also have to be visionaries. It means that we have to discuss these kind of problems at universities. We have to have discussion groups, retreats, to speak about societal questions. That belongs to the university teaching as well, not only the specialist teaching. We have to start to dream again, having visions and trying to invent in our dreams an ideal world and try to implement that world afterwards when we wake up. These visions are very important, and this is a very important saying here, that we should speak up whatever we have as freely as possible on all relevant subjects. It has been said in an earlier lecture all before. And you know, when we are so frank and open, we will make errors. But it's more important to be open-minded than to avoid errors, because in science we always make errors, and afterwards we can correct for these errors again. We can admit that we made an error and say it differently next time. And here's a saying of a German politician, that is a former German president, Roman Herzog. I know him personally. And he said, without critical opposition, without the engagement of relentless thinkers, a society will degenerate. We need embarrassment and disagreement. We need impertinence and questions of independent brains. And these are the academics who have this freedom to express what they think. So that's the graph which I like to with which I like to emphasize our responsibilities. First of all, we have to do basic research. That's important. Dig deep into the ground on this research level. But in addition, we have also to think on a societal and global level and acquire wit. See what's going on in the world and try to relate. So that's what we have to do internally in our universities. And then we go onto the ladder and look outside. See what is going on in our world and try to see what one could do better in our world. Of course, we have to question what is going on in politics. We cannot avoid that. And you know, in politics, justice is not important. What is important is justification. When a politician can justify what he's doing, then he's well off. He can do whatever he wants. He just has to justify himself. And you know, our globe has lost its equilibrium of power. We have this very strong weight here on this side, with the power here concentrated, and we belong to the powerlessness on this side. We are weak weights. And I mean, this statement summarizes very, very well what is contained in that other slide, being said by an American journalist, very famous, Robert Kagan. And he said the US cooks the dinner, these are the cooks, and the EU, these are just dishwashers. And I mean, the same is true, of course, also for the Islamic world. You are all just dishwashers. So that's this kind of view. And I mean, there is some truth in it. There is some truth in it, and we have to take it serious and try to work against it. I mean, you know, when you are strong, then you don't have to obey rules. You can be against the Kyoto Protocol, you can vote against the Human Rights Council, you can reject the International Criminal Court and all these things in between. You can behave and do whatever you want to do. Just be strong. But that's not decent. And that never will lead to an equilibrium on Earth. I mean, that was the last issue here, March 15th this year. The UN approves a new Council on Human Rights Abuse, and that's John Bolton here, and he said no. And I mean, you see here 170 votes for and 4 votes against, including him. I mean, it's not possible to change the world by changing, by force the mind of the neighbor, like here. We have to listen to Mahatma Gandhi, that we have to change ourselves and hope that this will change the world. We cannot go out by force to change others. That doesn't work. And he says it here in different words, an eye for an eye makes the entire world blind. And that's what's going on today. And it's going on in your world. And you know, bringing freedom is often just a pretext for extending the domain of influence and power. That's very clearly, I mean, don't believe. I mean, these who say it are very low down on the truth curve, you remember. And freedom alone is not good enough. Enjoy while you can. I mean, what is important actually is the freedom, the responsibility to help others, that leads to a feeling of personal freedom and not just to enjoying freedom. But whenever you fulfill your responsibility, then you feel free and then you get a good feeling and you can sleep well. What can we do, Europe and Asia? We have to strengthen the international organization, renew the UN, strengthen the International Criminal Court, and so on. These international laws, they are very important for keeping the world in equilibrium. So these international organizations, they help safeguarding a beneficial global future. That's what we can contribute, even if there is a big nation which is against it. We still have to fight for it. And there is another issue here, an issue, it has also been mentioned before, namely, the world of culture, heritage, and tradition, which is so important today, and the world of science and technology and progress on the other side, which starts to override this other part, which seems to be so much more important, and this red part in the background is being lost. But what we actually need would be a combined world, a dynamic world with a dynamical outskirt here where science is important, technology and progress, and the red heart is being maintained, the heart of culture, heritage, and tradition. So, I mean, in Turkish words, we need these kind of towers here in Istanbul, and we need this tower in Ankara at the same time. They have to live side by side. They belong together. And you know, cultural heritage and cultural diversity is as important as biodiversity. If we lose cultures, I mean, what do we have left on our earth? And you know that intelligent people who are deprived of their roots, they very often become terrorists. They don't have to lose anything whatsoever anymore. And then they sacrifice their own life. And so maintaining cultures, that's very, very, very important. And so I was so glad that this convention on the protection and promotion of the diversity of cultural expressions passed last year at UNESCO. And it passed actually very well. There were 148 votes for and 2 votes against. Just guess who are these 2 votes. Here they are. No comment. Anyway, I mean, that's a very, very old truth, which already has been pointed out by this gentleman, Einstein, in a letter exchange with Sigmund Freud. And Einstein has written to Sigmund Freud, "The quest for international security requires that each nation unconditionally surrenders some fraction of its liberty of action, of its sovereignty. And then we get a stable system." So one has to give up some freedom in order to make the system stable. And some countries haven't understood that at all. What has Europe contributed? I think the idea of unification really brightened up our dark world. I think that's a very important development which has taken place, except for the black sheep here in the center of Europe. And I'm very sorry that I have to stand in front of you as one of these black sheep who don't. But I would like to join, but my countrymen, they don't. So that's a great problem in the moment. And of course, the issue of Turkey, that's also a problem. It's still present. I mean, why not use this example, for example, in other domains of the world? Why not create an East Asian Union where the East Asian states would come together in a similar way as in Europe? That would solve a lot of problems. Why not have an East Asian Union where the South Asian states would come together in a peaceful manner? And why not have something like a Middle Eastern Union? I mean, one needs strength in order to fight these external influences. Otherwise, if one is divided and everybody has his egoistic goals, it will lead to nothing. So, I mean, the countries in this area, they carry a lot of responsibility for the present state and much responsibility for the future. So, but I mean, that has all to do with economy, of course. I mean, you have oil and you want to use that oil for your own personal purposes, and you don't think in a global way. That's all economy. And I mean, Adam Smith has said it, it's not the benevolence of the butcher, the baker, and the brewer that from which we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own personal interest. That's important. You do it everything for yourself. So that's the reason why the wealth is going up, at least for some people, and the values are slipping down to hell. And I mean, we have all become just consumers. And consumers in order to keep the industry going. We have to consume and eat as much as we can. And I mean, these beautiful advertisements in the Himalaya, these rock paintings, Coke and Pepsi. I mean, the Coca-Cola bottle, which has been created because of the 800th anniversary of Mongolia, so the 800th birthday of Genghis Khan. So I mean, something like the Genghis Coke, why not? I mean, the same happens here also with some different naming, but anyway, you know that money-mindedness corrupts. And you know that whenever you need in your teaching an exponential function, here it is, namely the ratio of the CEO salaries to the average US workers, which is going up and up and up and up. And I mean, that causes us sleepless nights. These excessive salaries contradict democratic fairness. I mean, it's not the money which is lost. It's not the money which is the problem. But it's this mistrust and the social unrest which can result from such a distribution of income. So I had a good idea, namely to create bonus certificates for CEOs, give them this kind of certificates, which they can spend exclusively for charitable contributions. So they can decide whether they want to give it to the Red Cross, to the Blue Cross, or to the Green Cross, or to the Yellow Cross, whatever. But that's all they can decide. And then I'm sure we could sleep better and they could sleep better as well. I mean, it has been said before that the free market concept has inherently a tendency to enrich the rich and impoverish the poor. And that's again our system. We do only something if we gain something for ourselves. It's this feedback which is the driving force. Egoism is the driving force of our world. And we should break this. And I mean, responsibility cannot result from human instincts to which Adam Smith's words refer. We need conscientious education and having convincing role models who do it properly. And that can motivate people to behave in a compassionate and in an unselfish way to help others. So this is a system which I'd like to see, an open loop system where we decide, where we experience this responsibility. We have to do something in order that society takes a profit from it. And that leads then from the free market economy to a responsible market economy. And this is the system which we have today. The profit-oriented free market, which lives from raw material, labor, it's driven by profits, by the shareholder value, produces products, a lot of garbage, damage and depletion. That's what I would like to see, a responsible market system, which is driven by foresight, societal responsibility, by conviction. We do something out of conviction. Profits are being reduced, shareholder value is being reduced, but there is a societal gain coming out. And garbage, damage and depletion are reduced as well. That's my dream. It's still, unfortunately, a dream, but I hope that we can work towards that. And I'm so glad that the Peace Prize of this year goes to the Grameen Bank of Bangladesh, where exactly these principles are being implemented. And the social entrepreneurs, which are doing the same. So, I mean, we could speak about ecology. I don't want to say much about that, you know, how bad our environment is and that you have to go inside of the house when you want to get some fresh air. It's all clear that you know that our glaciers are melting faster and faster. You know that there are some people who don't believe in global warming, for example, this gentleman here in his self-produced smoke. And he is destroying our environment. I mean, that's out of Science magazine, so I didn't draw that up. And you know that these climate changes which happen, they will widen the gap between the haves and the have-nots. It's the poor countries which will suffer most. And the rich countries, they might overcome that very well. So, I mean, that's why Arundhati Roy said the American way of life is simply not sustainable. It doesn't acknowledge that there is a world beyond America. But of course, there are other countries where misusage is happening, Caspian Sea with all this damage here. You know, the Aral Sea, which has completely disappeared, a man-made graveyard for these ships here. I mean, that doesn't look good. We are in the midst of an energy crisis. Of course, that's an important project here, the Ilyushu Dam project in Turkey, but it's also something which one has to seriously discuss. I don't want to go into the issues. And after all, sustainability is at first a proper mindset. Let me come to my third and last point, namely, let's become active. We have to not only observe what is going on, but we have to try to steer by providing advice and education. I mean, if we don't provide this kind of long-term concepts to society, education, inventions, knowledge, we don't deserve autonomy, we don't deserve finances. This closes the feedback loop. We have at ETH in Zurich, for example, this institute, this Collegium Helveticum, which is the old observatory of Zurich, where we try to conceive a beneficial global future, where these kind of thoughts are being developed. Just an example here from Franz Josef Rademacher. He proposed a global Marshall Plan. I don't want to go into the details. I mean, these are the kind of thoughts which should be developed at universities. And this is a representation of what I have in mind. A two-wheeler, the society, or the passengers on this vehicle, entertained by the politicians, kept in a good mood, that they don't jump off the vehicle. We have the enormously strong power wheel of industry driving the vehicle forward at maximum speed, maximum profit. It doesn't matter where it goes to, whether it goes to hell or not, doesn't matter. And we need somebody who steers. And I think that the academic community, at least to some extent, that we steer and give a direction where to go. And we need lifelong learning activities by courses, lectures, TV broadcasts to inform our public to what the proper goals would be. And I just like to show you to end up an example from last year. Last year, our ETH in Zurich had its 150 years jubilee, and we used that for teaching activities. We have sent 150 professors onto the streets of Zurich for teaching. So we are here on the hill. They had to go down into the lower parts of the city. We have built small temples for them, and in these temples they had to preach. Providing information, starting a dialogue with the public to get some feedback also. And you see myself standing here in one of these temples with my public. Obviously, I'm talking here about nuclear magnetic resonance. And people were fascinated. We had 430 lectures in 3 weeks and all these full houses. And in this way, you can try to get knowledge into the public. We had a hands-on experience park just near the railway station of Zurich. We had 220,000 visitors in just 3 weeks. There are standing lines, a display here just in the inside of the railway station of Zurich. We have here experiments for the smaller ones. We have experiments for the middle-aged ones, and here for grandma. And that's lifelong learning. Children's University, you have to start very early to excite children, and it's fascinating to stand in front of 300-400 children with their eyes looking at you and being fascinated what you tell them. And then intercultural dialogue. I just mentioned here one example. It doesn't refer to Islam, but to Buddhism in this particular case, where we teach in South Indian monasteries science to Tibetan monks. That's an initiative started by the Dalai Lama, and he thinks that knowledge of science is even important for monks. And that's what we are doing. We teach these monks science, and it's a great success. We send Swiss scientists to India, and they do this teaching. Last year, in our 150 jubilees activities, the Dalai Lama, he visited ETH. We had a discussion here with our science minister, the president, the Dalai Lama. And that was an intercultural discourse which was going on here with a Catholic tradition and the Dalai Lama. So this kind of dialogue helps to bridge gaps. And you know, when you want to have a good future, you have to suffer today. Like this little guy here, it's painful to give this injection, to receive this injection here. But that's what we have to do. And you know, our main responsibility is to educate leaders. Leaders with long-term vision, willing to serve society. That's our main obligation at universities. So we should become pathfinders of society. I'm really coming to the very end. François Rabelais has once said, science sans conscience n'est que ruine de l'âme. Science without conscience ruins the soul. We need that in addition. And this is my very last slide. I mean, so much is bad in our world. So much misery is occurring. We could blame so many other people, but we can't. We are ourselves responsible for the future. So we have to remain, despite of everything, optimists. That's optimism is our duty, as has been said by Karl Popper here. And we are jointly responsible for what will happen in the future and try to take active part in this responsibility. Thank you for your attention.